very soon for you. Two more quarterfinals to play out. The first of those that will be coming up next will be Pavel versus Hoy. And now Hoy is a player that you probably know a fair deal about. He's had some strong performances in majors. He's been on one of the premier Hearthstone teams in Na'Vi, recently disbanded, of course. But what can you tell us about Pavel, Savits?
Pavel is a Russian player who is very, very talented. He has made a lot of impressive results. Even in last year, he has been around for a long time. He's kind of like infamous for making a huge play, a huge mistake,
yes.
Excuse me, against the life coach with a Sylvanas by sequencing incorrectly in a huge, when the stakes were high at the European Championships last year, maybe due to being nervous, playing too quickly. It's been a year. Maybe he learned something.
Yeah, I mean, it's worth pointing out he's a very, very young, inexperienced player,
yes,
in live tournament environments. So, you know, it's hard not to feel for him. He's a very, very accomplished player. But, you know, his nerves just got the better of him. His brain just turned off for a moment. You know, he did a play that obviously he knows is wrong. And it cost him, you know, really a shot at a huge career over the last year. So now he's back in the driving seat to give himself a spot at BlizzCon again. But he has a big obstacle up ahead of him in Hoy, who, as I said, is one of the strongest tournament performers overall, but has not done well in HCT so far. He actually has a very poor record.
Yeah, I've heard that he has one of the worst prelim records,
yeah,
of all players, being knocked out every season very early on, not doing so well. He has been doing well in some other tournaments, yeah, for sure, but HCT has been rough for him. Maybe this is his moment. I mean, if he takes it here, it doesn't really matter what happened before. He will still be able to make it all the way to BlizzCon.
That's a good point. But Hoy, just before this tournament started, he tweeted out that, you know, he tries as hard as he can with his tournament lineups to get away from bad decks, as he called them in his tweet. But no matter what happens, he keeps coming back to Reno Lock. Now, Savits, you're a man that knows a little something about coming back to Reno Lock over and over again. What is it that draws certain people back to this deck over and over again?
It's just so interesting to play. There's so many decisions to be made. Playing that Reno Jackson makes you put 30 different cards in your deck, so every single turn you will have a lot of options. If you have 8 cards, you have 8 different plays potentially, depending on how much mana you have. Mm-hmm. There's so many different lines. The matchups differ from each other. There's a lot of tech cards that you can put in there. For example, like even Big Game Hunter is not completely out of the question in Reno Lock, just because of you want a certain answer to a certain card. So it's just a really interesting card to me to watch and to play. Just all the different decisions. When do you life tap? When do you go for tempo?
Mm-hmm. How do you feel like the Reno Lock is going to do specifically up against Pavel's lineup? Because, you know, Hoy was scared of bringing it, but it turns out there's like a ton of Control Warrior in this tournament, for example. So Reno Lock might be well positioned, but against Pavel, do you think it's going to have a big impact?
I guess we will see. I mean, I hope that Reno Lock does well, because it's one of my favorite decks, like I already mentioned. But I worry that he might struggle with it. Like he said himself, that he's not so sure if it was a good call to bring it.
Fair enough. So Pavel, from Pavel's side, you know, he's, as we said, a very, very young player. Do you think his experience, as you said, with the misplay, do you think that potentially plays into his head a little bit more and he can continue to be nervous again, you know, overthinking things? Or do you think he will have really worked on his focus overall coming into this series?
I honestly think that, because I know that he's a very, very talented player, and it's been over a year, so he has certainly learned something from it. And after misplaying like that big, I don't think it gets any worse. So,
it really doesn't, yeah.
So in comparison to that, like, I think this is going to go just fine.
Well, we will see. I'm expecting a much stronger performance from Pavel, and of course, Hoy, solid as always. But to find out who is going to take our first spot in the lower half of the semifinals, we have TJ and Frodan standing by.
Thank you very much, Saddle. Greetings from the commentator's desk. It is time to begin our third quarterfinal of the Last Call Invitational. My name is Frodan. I'm joined by TJ Sanders, one of my favorite people in the world to commentate, and it is our joy to bring you guys the next match, Hoy versus Paul. For anybody who's just tuning in, TJ, what have they missed so far?
Well, it's been a fun day so far. Last Call Invitational is the cream of the crop.
Yes.
So to speak. All these guys have been working hard all year long. RDU took the first match of the day, and we just saw Bunny Hopper as well move on to the semifinals. So coming up next, Hoy versus Pavel. These guys both were at the 2015 Europe Championship, but both fell short, finishing 5th through 6th. So they've been close to the championship, the
Very
World
close.
Championship, before, but we'll see if they can do it here.
TJ, I am very excited. I drank way too much coffee before this series, and I want to talk to you about why I'm excited for this series, specifically because these two guys are breaking the mold. You said cream of the crop. They're the last French fry at the bottom of the McDonald's bin. The best for last. Or I guess the third.
The third.
So yeah. The best second to last. Because last is the worst. No, I'm just kidding, of course. I'm saving it. I had too much coffee. Hoy is playing Rena Warlock, and we haven't seen Rena Warlock for a while. You did hear Sato talk about how Hoy said he doesn't want to bring bad decks, and yet he's still married to this Rena Warlock. He loves this deck. Why, TJ?
Why does he love
this deck so much?
They touched on it, but the only time we've seen Rena Warlock so far today in the last call invitational, it lost on turn 6.
I know.
To a mid-range shaman.
Oh, man.
Well, I guess it's a totem shaman with Bloodlust. But still, it has not put up good performances across many tournaments recently.
Yes.
But there have been a lot of players who have had success with it recently in ranked play. So that's something to look at. Pavel, on the other hand, is running a very interesting version of Tempo Mage. Seems minion heavy. It runs double Faceless Summoner, which is a 6-drop that summons a random 3-drop.
It has the Arcane Anomaly, a card that came out with One Knight in Karazhan that people originally thought would fit in this deck, and they have since taken it out. It has a 1-mana 2/1 minion that gains health every time you cast a spell, so it's sort of a nice contrast to the Mana Worm. And he's running that, and he's running Ragnaros, as you can see in his list, with no Yogg-Saron. He's the only person also playing a Tempo Mage variant. All other other mages decks have been Freeze Mage variants. So you can see that Pavel's thinking outside the box, and it does happen to line up against a Rena Warlock, which is a good matchup on paper for the mage deck, because the Rena Warlock lowers his own health naturally, and you can use your burn, especially if you run two Firelance portals. Pavel's got a lot of power that's in his deck from head to toe.
Yeah, this was used to be an interesting matchup a long time ago. You know, when Rena Warlock first came to power, soon after League of Explorers, or I guess a few months after League of Explorers, because it was a mix of, you know, when to sort of use your burn and when to go for it, as opposed to like when to try and play the board control role and play around Reno and things like that. So there's a little bit of dance that happens in the mid game if both players have a relatively decent early game, and that's where a lot of the decision making comes in.
Speaking of decision-making, I love that attack from Pavel to ignore the 1-1 minion and go to Hoy's life total. A lot of people would probably pick up an easy value trade to protect some of their minions and also get early board control. But Pavel's recognizing that his hand is not looking very aggressive and he needs to start getting the damage in. A position that Rena Warlock wants to be in is they've stabilized the board early and then they can start using the mid-stage of the game to life tap, catch up in the card count, and start having more decisions, more powerful options and removals, or even more scary option is if Pavel starts seeing Hoy drops big threats without having much pressure on them. When Sylvanas and Cairn come down, and there's not a lot of pressure going up against them, that's when Rena Warlock's at its best.
Also, Rena Warlock is an interesting deck to play against because you only ever have to play around a single copy of each individual card. So you're not necessarily punished as much for pushing damage, because if there's a Mortal Coil in their deck, you only have to play around one. If there's a Shadow Bolt in the deck, you only have to play around one. Shadow Flame, Hellfire, you only have to play around one, and you know that.
I sense a theme here.
There's only one!
There's
one of everything!
One. And at this point, Hoy is a little bit awkward because he can't really fully remove the board with Hellfire. Flamewaker would survive, but he does remove 6 power on the board, and maybe he can bank on the fact that his opponent doesn't have many cards in hand. Mm-hmm. I do feel like Flamewaker is a huge threat, but it is also threatening for the other two cards that are on the board. Sorcerer's Apprentice and Flamewaker make both of those cards way more threatening when they're played in tandem as opposed to separately. So I wouldn't be opposed to just playing Hellfire here. Yes, the Flamewaker survives, but if you use Shadow Bolt on the 2/4, you're still leaving 6 power on the board, and Sorcerer's Apprentice is extremely threatening too in its own right.
This is one of the most threatening board states that you could ever possibly imagine in the early game of Hearthstone. Mm-hmm. It's one of the reasons why Temple Mage is strong, because of these three cards.
I've had a situation before where my opponent's Flamewaker and Sorcerer's Apprentice was on the board. I couldn't remove both of them, so instead I chose to play 2 Arcane Giants, an Ancient of War, and I still had Fandral on the board. So it was a 10-10. And I still lost from that position, because they just had so many cheap spells that cycled. Like, they had an Arcane Explosion that was dealing 2 damage to everything. It was just like super strong turn, and I still lost because of the Arcane Blast. The Arcane Intellects were really cheap.
Yeah, it's very threatening. Which one do you kill? If you can not in like this position anyway, but if you have a Cult Sorcerer, a Sorcerer's Apprentice, and a Flame Waker on the board, and your opponent has one card in hand, and you can kill any, just you know, a spell that kills it.
It's tough, man. I think I have to still choose the Flame Waker just because Flame Waker can be seen as a plus two spell damage card because of the way it adds two damage to every spell you play versus Cult Sorcerer. So there's that answer. And then the Sorcerer's Apprentice is just threatening just for its own right. But I generally have to feel like Flame Waker just has way more potential to kill you.
The correct answer was Go Face.
None, just Go Face. Well, in this situation, Pavel's actually caught in an awkward position. He actually has a people might think that the only option is to ping the opponent, but he actually has an option to ping his own Thanos to draw a card because he might need to play something, and he has the most expensive cards in his deck. The only card that he can draw here that'd be the worst card would be Flamestrike if he pings. Everything else is... Oh, actually, he has the Face of Summoners as well, but everything else is four or lower.
Yeah, if he picks up one of those extra two drops, if he picks up a Water Elemental, which he has two of in the deck...
I apologize. Azure Drake. So Azure Drake and Face of Summoners. So that's five cards out of the remaining that he can also play. It is worth evaluating. Chooses instead just the Hero Power. I wouldn't blame him for that because I feel like there's a lot of downside of just doing that. You could be stuck not playing anything and you have no board.
Yeah, but decides to keep it alive. Mm-hmm. The extra damage that he pushes this turn, along with the extra damage potentially that he could push next turn, ends up being... more damage on average in his mind than if he had just pinged it off and tried to draw on something. And Hoi is in some trouble. He's got some big boys to play, but he is low without a Reno Jackson in hand. And guess what, Dan? There's only one.
You know, Sylvanas is not a male, so I resent your statement. I am triggered. Hoi actually has a lot
big
of
ladies.
Choices.
Big boys and big ladies. I'm so sorry.
Yes, please. We are friend. We are neutral here.
And
in the
Mountain ACT. Giant is genderly ambiguous. So,
I sexually identify as Mountain Giant. Well, I am all things to all people, but too heavy to play. You know, he plays Emperor Thorzin because it does reduce the cost of everything in his hand. Firelance Portal drops this Shadow Pan Rider, but what's important is that right now Hoi is within fireball range to die, so it just feels like he has to play stuff. And I do like the Emperor Thorzin because in the case he needed to play Twisting Nether this turn, he could. But if not, he also has a turn earlier where Sylvanas Shadow Flame is also better. So even though Sylvanas, you can get it on the board, or Mountain Giant's an 8-8 more threatening, I think Hoi definitely chose the Emperor given the fact that he needed to open up his range of plays for the following turns.
But this is quite scary if you're Hoi, because even though you may not be dead on board and you know your opponent had an opportunity to kill last turn, but didn't, they played Firelands Portal, they didn't have that fireball available, it's still a very scary situation. And relying on one card to bail you out without being able to tap or without, tapping this turn is very, very scary. And you might have to just sort of take the risk at some point.
The Twisting Nether makes the most sense just because he has to remove all the damage. He just, and what's really unfortunate is that he couldn't, Leeroy Shadow Flame because the Shadow Pan Rider would survive. Koi's game plan here is now, of course, shifted from just trying to stabilize to trying to survive. And we know Pavel's got a lot of damage. He picks up Fireball, so he almost certainly will be able to kill his opponent unless Hoi's able to draw to Reno Jackson or surprises with another card. Because even if he plays Reno, he still has to deal with this Ragnaros. And that's not it. So I think Hoi is going to try to play the Sylvanas and steal the Rag and hope that his opponent doesn't have the removal. But that means he's just dead to literally any damage in the deck.
Yeah, it's what's a higher percentage play in his mind? Is it tapping for the one of Reno Jackson in his deck when he hasn't even been through that much of his deck yet? Mm-hmm. Or is it hoping that your opponent doesn't have a single burn spell, whether that be Frostbolt, Fireball, Firelands Portal, anything really?
Yeah. I actually think it's a higher likelihood that he gets Reno Jackson and wins the game from that than expecting the mage not to have burn, because Pavel had so much opportunities just to put on that pressure. Not to mention that there's always like Babbling Book that can create the scenario too. So he taps, tries to go for it, sees that it's not an option, so instead he chose goes for Sylvanas and Power Overwhelming. Absolutely reasonable play, but he is absolutely dead here, TJ.
Oh, yeah. And even Arcane Missiles probably would have been enough. Mm-hmm. And draws face the Summoner, so even with a slow hand, or a relatively slow hand, passing a few turns in the mid-game from Pavel, he got a good enough start.
Yep.
And he was able to capitalize on Reno Warlock again.
Yeah, I mean, Temple Mage is heavily favored on paper against the Reno Warlock for this reason. You can just keep putting them into the corner. It's like, do you have Reno Jackson? No, then I'm most likely just going to kill you. Mm-hmm. And even if they don't have the burn, they just the fear of it also forces Reno Warlock to play very awkwardly many times.
Yeah, we're going to see what's going to happen in game number two right after this. Welcome back, everybody. We're about to jump into game number two between Pavel and Hoi. And Hoi, I don't know, man.
TJ.
He even tweeted it out. He said, I'm going to try and go away from bad decks.
When you look at Hoi, and when you look at Hoi, you can't help but think about his teammates and the accolades that they've been able to accomplish, both individually and together. One of them, of course, is Osaka, 2015 world champion and nationally recognized as a treasure of Sweden. Hero extraordinaire. I'm pretty sure Osaka also is a firefighter in his spare time, carrying saving kittens from trees and carrying kids on the back.
You go to Stockholm, there's just a statue of him.
Yeah, you might not expect it. You might not expect him based off his build, his young, slender, Swedish build. But at the same time, it is true. He is the savior of kittens and small children from fire building or buildings on fire. But you look at him and you look at Sixo, who's also number one ranked right now on Ghostu Gamers and just doing very well across every tournament that he enters. Probably a top five player in the world, guaranteed, based off of many peer reviews. And you look at Hoi and you think, he did really well last year. I mean, he did get to last call last year as well. I mean, he also got cheesed by Osaka in the Europe Championships, for lack of a better term. Like, Osaka knew Hoi would be in his group and kind of biased his decks accordingly. And lost twice to him.
Yeah.
But a lot of the reason why I feel that that Hoi is not performing as well as his teammate is because of his love for Reno Lock. I feel like he's too enamored by that deck. And can I just tell you how many thousands of dollars I feel like Hoi has lost in competition because he brings Reno Lock too much? That's a lot, TJ.
I can imagine. Yeah. Hoi has actually been a part of many major tournaments where he's finished third, fourth at a few DreamHacks.
Right.
Fifth to sixth at a couple of majors. Imagine if those were, first or seconds.
He just brought Zoo instead. Yeah. Maybe. It could be in that situation, but of course the past is in the past. I'm harping on it a little bit too much. Let's focus on the present. Druid versus the Rogue. Now, Hoi did start off with Wild Growth. Now he has the Mire Keeper, so he can go for even more ramp. And by the time that Pavel gets his fourth mana crystal, Pavel will be sitting on the opposite turn hitting seven, which is really scary.
Yeah. But Hoi doesn't really have much to do in his hand. So he's going to be relying on drawing from the Wrath potentially or getting a big minion off of the top of his deck. So I believe that was a Fandral, which would be perfect pickup. Wow.
Wow.
That is incredible.
TJ redefining caster vision, being able to use that elite skills and see what's being ripped off the top here. Wrath, four damage, perfect. Just to sweet spot it and cycle through as well. Looking forward to picking up some of his big heavy minions. Now, I know a lot of you guys are thinking, what's the card? What's the card that replaces Yogg-Saron? Because only half the players that brought this druid brought Yogg-Saron. And the answer to that question might surprise you, TJ. It is not going to be a card that helps you ramp. It's not a really big, fat Ancient of War, which a lot of people pick up. That card that Hoi has replaced Yogg-Saron with is Baron Geddon. And I don't know if that's really helpful in this matchup when you're staring down things like a Concealed Gadgetzan Auctioneer, but it's an interesting choice. Hoi's trying to mix it up, putting Baron Geddon in his druid decks.
It's a sort of crazy choice. If you think about it, Baron Geddon isn't even played a lot of the time in decks that it's classically been played in, and Control Wear, most notably. So it's
or Astral Communion Druid.
Or Astral Communion Druid.
That's all the two decks that I can think Berengeddon goes in.
And Berengeddon's not even one of those minions that you get it off the top and you're like, oh, cool.
Yeah.
Berengeddon.
Yeah.
An Ancient of War is almost always going to be a decent play.
Yeah, it's true.
And you think about Berengeddon, you're like, well, Berengeddon might just deal more damage to me than it helps me on the board. So it's definitely a meta call. Berengeddon can be really good against Shamans.
Yes.
And Hoi did ban...
his opponent Shaman.
He banned his opponent. Oh my God.
I mean, it also could be a fact that
ridiculous.
I mean, it depends, right? He's looking at the lineups as he does choose to Wrath here. I completely agree with this Wrath. Try to make sure his cycle's hand's not looking very impressive right now. Oh, I thought he was Wrathed. Okay, I apologize.
Well, he Wrathed, but he Wrathed for three to clear off the Gadget Auctioneer.
Interesting.
So
what do you think about that play, TJ?
I mean, the Gadget Auctioneer, I feel like, is super threatening, and you need to kill it somewhere or another. And it's either you trade in your 3-3 or you keep it on the board. Your opponent didn't clear off your 3-3 last turn. Mm-hmm. They use a Gadget Auctioneer with just a prep and one spell, which means that I think they're sort of desperate to find additional answers. Usually you save your Gadget Auctioneer for additional turns. But maybe you feel like the Fandral is a little bit too threatening. So I feel like keeping that 3-3 on the board is a little more important than getting one card further in your deck.
I think it makes sense, given that Hoi wants to play Maligos next turn, too. Because when he drew Maligos, he says, if I play Maligos next turn, I want to have this 3-3 on the board to help fight for board control in case he plays SI7 Agent or something else where 3-3 can start getting damage in. Plus, in the event that Maligos gets sapped, which you, of course, is the worst-case scenario, I still have some board presence as opposed to feeling like I lost that much tempo, 7 mana or more. Pablo played Emperor Thorstan, another card that you don't see that often in the Rogue, but when you know that it's Maligos Rogue, it makes a lot more sense. The Sinister Strikes become free, and then Pablo can put that damage on.
Dan, I think, whoa, wow, okay. Backstab is actually a huge pickup, because otherwise he would have been dead, and he might even be dead anyway. He's dead anyway.
Oh, the swipe and the living roots?
Yeah, swipe will be 9 damage. Living roots will be 7 damage. So that's 16 right there. The attack from the Maligos will be 20, and a hero power will be 21. So I don't even think there's any way for Pavel to survive here.
That is a brilliant line that Hoi was able to take from keeping this 3-3 alive. And I know a lot of people would emphasize cycling on that Gadgetzan Auctioneer with the Wrath, particularly because their hand context was looking a little bit weak, because your turn would just be keeping a 3-3 on board. But when he sees Maligos in the hand, sees that he can set up for these big plays, love the fact he's able to spot this, and now he is rewarded as Hoi should be able to finish this game off rather easily and take the series to a tied 1-1 score.
Yeah, that was actually quite a fast game.
Yeah.
Hoi was able to just ramp up incredibly effectively early on, you know, being 3 mana ahead of Pavel. He got Maligos plus spells early and was able to put himself in a position to capitalize on really a heavy ramp start, but a weak mid game, I suppose. So,
yeah.
Definitely impressive.
Duh, good job there. You know, we kind of expect Druid to do Druid-type things, and it's definitely a little bit too... That statement is cheapening what ended up happening that game, but you get to see the power of just getting a lot of mana crystals, because a lot of the reason why that was even able to happen was because Hoi had the mana on that turn to play Maligos and Moonfire, versus if he didn't have the 2 Mire Keepers and the Wild Growth, he'd be definitely a few crystals short and be in an awkward spot. Maybe he did end up swiping the Gadgetzan or cycling with the Wrath instead. So a lot of the hand context ended up coming because of the way Druid was able to ramp into things, and that's why it's such a powerful deck, which is why I think a lot of people unfairly put a lot of responsibility on the Yogg-Saron. You know, Maligos is a heavy lifter as well, and definitely really threatening no matter what it does.
Yeah, for sure. One interesting thing that we haven't really talked about, we were talking about a little bit during the break, is Pavel decided to ban the Rogue away from Hoi.
Yeah, it's also really interesting.
Sort of an odd ban. You don't see many Rogue bans nowadays, especially when Shaman exists in the lineup and Warrior exists in the lineup, which have been, you know, the go-to bans for a long time. Even if you look at sort of the way the meta developed, with people bringing more control style lists, they'll ban Hunter away as sort of that fifth deck. Now, neither of these players have Hunter, but Rogue is what Pavel decided on after seeing these lists.
Yeah, I mean, Rogue is one of those decks that is a control buster, like really does a good job messing up the control decks, which is interesting that Hoi chose not to ban it. But of course, you know, when you look at the way the Rogue is individually built, you see that Hoi, for example, brought the faster Miracle Rogue that doesn't have Malleus Ghost, just the normal versions with Violet Teachers. That ends up winning, or sorry, with
Questing Adventures,
that teacher's been cycled out for a while. But that wins compared to the speed of the Malleus, of course, compared to that. So then he feels like he's already disadvantaged there. And, of course, the Rogue is really good against a few other slower options. Mid-range Shaman is running Ragnaros. He's running Ragnaros and the Temple Mage variants, too. So it just feels like it has a lot of opportunity to just swing against him. So I don't blame him for taking out that Rogue. And Rogue is definitely one of the scarier classes now that the patch has come through, because one of the Rogue's worst matchups was the Aggro Shaman.
Yeah.
And no one's really playing that anymore.
No, the hit to Rockbiter, I think, really hurt, because you can no longer piece together a lot of those bursts. Doomhammer effectively would just beat Rogues because they have no way to stop that damage and hit face every single turn. So.
Yeah.
But yeah, you saw Rogue increase in popularity over the course of the championship. So now in Last Call, it's at a higher representation than ever, I think, with five players bringing Rogue out of the eight in the field, which is incredibly impressive.
I love it. Yeah. I love it. I think Rogue is one of those classes that's been defined as good as you can pilot it, because there's so many games as Rogue, you're dealt with awkward hands. They don't always line up for the gadgets and Auctioneer. You're not always dealt with the coin and an extra card. You're not even necessarily guaranteed to combo correctly with Conceal and all these other things. You have to piece it together very awkwardly half the time. You have the Cold Blood and SI 7 Nation Conceal it. Like these are the turns that really make the Rogue really fun to play.
Yeah.
Now, here is an interesting situation that we're dealt with. The fact that the Warriors are matched up together. And TJ, you have a lot to say because you've played a lot of Warrior over the years at Hearthstone. What's your take on the fact that we have a C'Thun Warrior up against a Control Warrior that's running cards like Tinkmaster Overspark in his lineup?
Well, this one's going to be interesting because both of these players have very different builds of the Warrior. Hoi has a N'Zoth Control Warrior. Mm-hmm. With some tools that are, you know, relatively decent in the sort of a control mirror. He's a little bit heavy on the threats. Tinkmaster Overspark can be fantastic in N'Zoth Warrior mirror specifically, but also against C'Thun Warrior, which is what Pavel is running. Because if you can isolate C'Thun and, you know, polymorph it, so to speak, with Tinkmaster Overspark, that ruins the effect of Doomcaller. So there's some really cool things that can happen if both players know each other's decks, because they can play around these possible scenarios.
Yes.
By like making sure that you land Emperor Thorsan on, say, Shield Slam and C'Thun, so that way you can kill off your own C'Thun to guarantee that you can get brand Doomcaller value to put two C'Thuns back in your deck automatically.
It's pretty
really,
complicated.
Yeah, but it's one of the most interesting Control Warrior mirror matchups, because a lot of the times, or not a lot of the times, because it can always be different, but it doesn't come down to that weird battle where people are passing a lot and, you know, it comes down to like Elise Starseeker legendaries, because, you know, the C'Thun Warrior doesn't run the Elise, even though N'Zoth does. A lot of times, once it gets to that critical point in the late game, each player is trying to do their own thing, but they're not trying to just get a bunch of legendaries with Elise.
Yeah, so what ended up happening in Control Warrior mirrors when they're very similar is one person gets really ahead in armor, the other person tries to not get too ahead in the card draw. It kind of gets a little drawn out and, you know, frankly, a little bit slow. But not necessarily in this case because of the reasons you mentioned. Also, I really like how different the deck lists are. As you can see, Paolo's going to easily get this snipe with the Fiery War Axe, get value out of it. I don't think he even necessarily minds drawing here. Because, again, the lists are very different. It's not going to come down to fatigue.
Yeah. The C'Thun Warrior tends to be the aggressor in this matchup more so than not, because without Elise, they don't have that inevitable win condition. I guess their inevitable win condition in this case is C'Thun, which isn't like Elise in the fact that you don't want to go to you don't want to make the game go to fatigue. You want to power cycle to a big C'Thun, make sure that you get your guarantee yourself more, and just put your opponent on the pressure test.
Which is interesting because Pavel doesn't even play the fast drawing version of the C'Thun Warrior. He's playing more the slow grind version. So his game plan is a little bit murky because of that. However, he already has C'Thun in hand, so that's a good start. He keeps the coin, which could be really important if he wants to C'Thun coin Shield Slam. These are all things to consider moving forward. Not to mention that Hoi also has some really powerful stuff, even if Elise isn't relevant. He also has Zoth, and if there comes to the point where he can bait out Brawls or his opponent doesn't have it, that can also be really strong. Already starting to shape up to be a pretty decent hand for Pavel, though. He's got the Emperor. He can reduce C'Thun and Shield Slam already. Mm-hmm. So that's already a pretty good opportunity. And if he doesn't use the coin, he can always use Bran and the Doom Caller there anyways without having to discount it.
Those are the sort of the big things to look for in this matchup. Pavel might also feel just comfortable if he has multiple minions on the board, playing C'Thun without having to kill it, because leaving that body around can be a big effect.
That's true.
Or he might just put Hoi on not having Tink Master over Spark, but that's a little bit of a risky play, considering if your C'Thun does get polymorphed, you essentially lose. Have zero chance to win.
Yes.
Because you just don't have enough threats in your deck to overcome, you know, N'Zoth or N'Zoth Warrior, or even Hoi just playing out the long game and just running out of resources. Because since he's committing to cycling through his deck faster early on in the game, he's saying, I'm not going to win the fatigue no matter what, so I'm going to just try and get through my deck as quick as possible and put on as much pressure as possible.
Hoi thinking, what's the best way to deal with this C'Thun's chosen? He has a slam for an easy cycle, and then he can bash, or he can keep his weapon, depending on what his draw is. There's a couple of interesting cards, too, that might influence his decision, how it changes. If he plays the Taunt, for example, or if he gets Harrison Jones. These are things like that could influence his draws based off slam. He also could try not to cycle, depending on if he wants to play it slow or not. Chooses instead to just use Baron Geddon and remove some of his health total. Get the biggest threat possible. If his opponent has the Ancient Shield Bearer, he needs to coin out the Shield Slam. And this is a matchup where you're kind of happy to see the coin being used just for removal, because you want your opponent to use it as opposed to saving it to Shield Slam your own minions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very true. So an interesting situation presented to Pavel, because the dance that you have to do, Dan, the C'Thun dance, there's a lot of things that you have to ensure happen for you to win this game, while simultaneously making sure that you put on pressure, or, you know, some semblance of pressure, like present a threat to your opponent every turn, something along those lines. And playing Emperor this early actually is a little bit weird, because now you sort of have to hold on to the coin, because you need to ensure that you get Bran plus Doomcaller, because I don't think two C'Thuns is going to be enough. We need to go deeper. We need three C'Thuns.
Three C'Thuns is all you get, though, because there is only one Doomcaller. But you're absolutely right. Now, Pavel can't really part ways with the coin unless it's a desperate situation, or he can just pressure his opponent. It's not like Hoi played Justicar on turn six. That is something that you are very afraid of in this matchup, no matter what kind of control warrior mirror it is or slow warriors, is that your opponent has Justicar, starts tanking up, and then gets out of the range of any kind of pressure that you can build up on. And then the life totals end up getting in the 60s, 70s, maybe even higher.
Maybe even the 80s.
Maybe even the 80s.
Damn.
It was a weird time for everybody, but the 90s was full of awkward haircuts and everything like that.
What about today? The 80s, 90s, and today?
What do we even call it today? The 10s? The 2010s? I don't even know, man. It's a weird time for everybody.
We'll see in 10 years when the next Kids Bop comes out.
Oh, God. Hoi ends up just kind of letting the initiative be taken here by Pavel. Pavel's up to 49 health, just like that.
And he's got plenty of armor to make sure that he can kill off his own C'Thun.
Yeah. But
without having to use the coin.
That might be something that's on the back of Hoi's mind, trying to keep his opponent's armor low enough so he can't Shield Slam his own C'Thun.
Which is
already extremely counterintuitive. If you've never watched this kind of matchup before and you're kind of new to Hearthstone, this is extremely confusing. Why would you want to Shield Slam your own C'Thun and as opposed to remove your opponent's minions? But trust me, this is like really important that Pavel keeps his armor count high and Hoi tries to present threats.
Yeah. Another thing is that maybe Pavel will feel like he doesn't have to Shield Slam his own C'Thun if he can put Hoi on not having Tink Master over Spark. But it's very risky, because also, if you play C'Thun this early and Shield Slam it, then you give your opponent a lot of time to build up armor and or find answers to the C'Thun. So you kind of want to do it like all at once. You kind of want to be like C'Thun, Shield Slam, Bran, Doomcaller, C'Thun, C'Thun.
Yeah. And here's another possibility too. Sylvanas stealing the C'Thun too.
Yeah.
So it's not even necessarily just Tank Master, just two threats. And that increased the consistency twice over.
Yeah.
So Pavel's definitely not going to look to play C'Thun on the empty board. Now we're also getting to the point where Hoi recognizes that Pavel's going to be on 10 cards very soon. And so he's just choosing not to play it slow, force out a threat from Pavel, use removal very optimally, and then force Pavel to be in this position where he constantly has to develop onto the board, or in the worst case scenario, toss away the coin. So that's it, or best case maybe for Hoi. So this is a situation where he's slow playing it. A lot of opportunities you can see, like Pavel doesn't necessarily want to play Shield Block. Hoi doesn't necessarily want to play Accolade of Pain. And this is where the counterintuitive behavior really starts to flesh out to see who understands this matchup better, or if they understand it both equally, who's the one who prepared better for their late game plans.
There's, for lack of a better term, some dumb things that can go on in this matchup. There's a possibility that Hoi can kill off his own Sylvanas to steal C'Thun, and then kill off the C'Thun that he just stole to stop Pavel from killing off his own Sylvanas to steal the C'Thun back.
That's true. There is the Sylvanas thief wars, so to speak. And so that is a possibility going in the back of his mind. But until he sees that, Hoi's the one who still has to present something. I mean, Pavel's game plan is pretty straightforward in the sense that he's just going to try to make sure to play his C'Thun combo. Hoi's the one who has to be able to make sure to threaten his opponent a little bit. Because if he plays too slow, Pavel's going to be able to execute his game plan flawlessly.
Yeah. And Pavel, though, continues to draw into cards that don't help him along the way to killing Hoi any faster. I suppose Gore Howl can be. But Pavel is really thinking about now, is this the time to go for it? And I don't think that it's going to be. So just armor up.
Execute being 2 mana. Not really relevant in this matchup at all. It's more important for the matchups that Ward tries to gain the tempo and develop other stuff. Pavel's also really scared about Gore Howl because he knows that his opponent runs Harrison Jones. So that's always in the back of his mind of whether or not Hoi can use it. And yes, while you don't want to draw too deep into your deck in this matchup, Gore Howl is a completely appropriate use for Harrison Jones to remove and draw a card.
And Hoi is also right now just, I think, 3 cards ahead in the fatigue battle anyway.
Is he?
Wow. There's been 2 Acolyte draws and a Shield Block.
Yeah, we should get a card check on that because that is extremely relevant of whether or not Hoi wants to do it. Neither player has hit their Just Card True Heart either, which has been actually a little bit refreshing for the matchup. I feel like when it starts getting to Tank Up Wars, and ends up getting to the very clowny part where it's just like they just get to 80, 90, 100 health or more. So it ends up becoming this very conservative resource battle of like, how do I actually budget my card draw and my life totals, if at all?
Yeah, both players get tank up, and then that's when your eyes start to like gloss over and you start contemplating life and all the decisions you've made. Those embarrassing moments in third grade.
Or even last year's EU championship.
Last year's EU championship.
Too soon.
Too soon, TJ.
Here's a question. Do you think Pavel has a legitimate choice of playing the second Fiery War Axe and encouraging his opponent to play Harrison on it? So say he attacks with this Fiery War Axe number one and just equips the second Fiery War Axe, and then just like say, you can't play Harrison Jones now because you're going to draw way too deep in your deck.
Yeah.
I actually really like this play. It's very creative.
He's also keeping the armor in check. And I mean, basically, as soon as Pavel draws...
in check. 43 health.
Well, he's negating it. He's dealing 1 damage per turn. There's the Tink Master over Spark. And a possibility of a key card in this matchup. I mean, it may not see use is the thing, which is the weird thing. But it's definitely on both players' minds as a key card.
Okay, so Hoi, once again, introduced with this awkward situation of, should I be playing cards like Shield Block in order to dig deeper into the deck, or can I just play it slow, play the Infested Tauren, which feeds directly into the Fiery War Axe, which is not something you want, primarily because Fiery War Axe is a card that is fantastic in the early game, but against decks that thrive itself off of late game value, it usually doesn't do much. So specifically in Warrior vs. Warrior in this case, Fiery War Axe doesn't actually usually get value. So by playing cards like Infested Tauren, you actually give value to your opponent with cards that normally do nothing.
Yeah. All right, well, here we go. Gonna get the C'Thun, put the armor down to 7, kill it off with his own shield slam to put that in the pool for Doomcaller to rip it right back out.
Yeah, actually twice over if he can pick up the Brand's Bronzebeard. Now, if Brand is the 30th card in the deck, that is going to be unfortunate for Pavel, but you know, fortunately for him, he has some ways to stall for it. He's got plenty of removal through Brawl in case his opponent plays a big board. And he also has Gore Howl, but at the same time, Hoi, what is he going to be doing here? He just saw that his opponent Shield Slam C'Thun, so if he's anticipating a Doomcaller with Brand Bronzebeard next turn, what's his best response?
It's tough to say. And he can't really play Nuzoth. Well, he can play Nuzoth, but he's not really going to pull back much. He still hasn't played Sylvanas, and I feel like you kind of want Sylvanas to come back, and you can't really play Sylvanas on an empty board because you have to hold on to it to... Well, I guess it doesn't really matter anymore.
What do you think about a Tink Master in your own Acolyte play? I mean, you already saw that your opponent played C'Thun.
Yeah.
And you CO slam it.
But
is it important to keep it as removal for your opponent's C'Thun?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. He might feel like he needs to hold on to it to make sure that... He's thinking that there's going to be 2 more C'Thuns that are going to come.
Okay.
And he needs to get a card out of his hand, so instead of trying to make something happen this turn, he's going to give himself one more turn by Bash to the Face. Probably the least important card out of the ones in his hand. Mm-hmm. C'Thun Chosen is not bad here. Still going to buff C'Thun wherever it is.
It's very much in basically wherever that is, I guess, left side of the board, match history bar, just chilling. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I think there is value to keeping the Acolyte as well. If your opponent is on fatigue and he mistakenly plays Sylvanas and expects nothing to happen, you can force your opponent to steal your Acolyte, force draws into it, fatigue damage ends up kicking in, your opponent takes way too much damage because they were a little bit sloppy on that. So I it was just a thought, you know, maybe transforming your own Acolyte because you don't really want to draw with it. But at the same time, I think you're completely right, TJ. Saving it for removal plus the threat of giving your Acolyte away. So now Ravaging Ghoul gets picked up. Does that change anything for Hoi? Not really. I guess he wishes he had his Bash so he can get an easy removal on it.
Yeah, that's kind of rough.
Mm-hmm.
And still doesn't want to draw cards, so... if his game plan stays the same, Acolyte of Pain and Shield Block are off the menu.
Yes. And, of course, Fiery War Axe is sitting there waiting to get value. And once again, you're giving value to a card that's not supposed to get much value in this matchup. So your opponent's just climbing ahead in resources, fighting very efficiently. Chooses to play Sylvanas. And he's aware of the risks of this. He knows his opponent can steal his Sylvanas as well. But I feel like given his situation, he doesn't have much choice.
Yeah. And it's quite awkward as well, just for the fact that the Divine Shield makes so he can't trade in that well, but actually Revenge plus just a trade-in eliminates the board.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wait, I apologize. If Hoi's been paying close attention, he knows that both Shield Slams have been used, so he actually doesn't lose his Sylvanas.
Oh, yeah, that's right. The first one was used on Baron Geddon.
Yes, yes.
So, and the second one was used to kill off his own C'Thun, so...
That's an appropriate risk, though, I think. Yeah. Plus, he has Nuzoth, too, so, you know, he can bring it back. Although Nuzoth doesn't really do too much in the face of Brawl. You hope that Karen can come down first. Karen is a very high-value legendary minion, which is drawn, so Hoi does have a very good play this turn. How is he best going to deal with the board here? Does he perhaps ignore the C'Thun's Chosen, tries to get his opponent's armor down, or perhaps just trade because he knows the Sylvanas is going to come back?
It's interesting.
He can also steal the C'Thun's Chosen with a Ravaging Ghoul Karen play. And it's a possibility as well.
Yeah. Leaving it at 1 health. But I mean, I guess every minion sort of matters in this situation.
Oh, sure. Just baiting removal out of your opponent and putting reasonable pressure.
Doesn't feel like doing 5 damage really does much of anything.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, you're going to have to do that 5 damage one way or the other. And presenting this threatening of a board with Nuzoth sort of to back it up might dissuade your opponent from being able to play Brand Doomcaller if they have it. Twin Emperor Vec'Lore is pretty decent, but it doesn't really do much against the current state of the board except for buy some time.
Well, it's actually not bad if you combine it with Revenge, because then If you could revenge and then you kill off the Ravaging Ghoul, because Lord knows you have enough health that you can spare it, Twin Emperor does get a force 2/4/6 taunt on the board, and then the Karen can't really trade efficiently into it. It will end up dying. There is also a possibility that Pavel plays Brawl this turn. He has two of it. He can also play Sylvanas, given that his opponent has a very awkward hand or awkward board to deal with Sylvanas.
Play Sylvanas Brawl.
Yeah, he could, because Sylvanas coin Brawl.
But I think, he could play Sylvanas with Brawl.
Oh, the 4-mana Brawl, you're right.
Yeah, but I think that's definitely going to be saved for when N'Zoth comes out, because then you have a much higher likelihood of being able to steal a potent Death Rattle minion. I was actually just going to go and play the Sylvanas now.
Okay.
He's got to get something out of his hand this turn, so it's either Soldier Sylvanas or the Twin Emperor Veklor.
Yes.
And maybe he feels like if N'Zoth comes out, he's going to use the second Brawl in that case scenario. So we know that he has a plan. He's got to be planning ahead. Well, what happens if this? What happens if this?
Right.
If he plays N'Zoth, am I going to have a way to deal with it? And the answer to that question is a definite yes. Still needs to start finding more stuff, further his own win condition, though, instead of just not losing.
Well, I like that Pavel plays Sylvanas here. What I like about it is that threatens to steal Karen to a certain degree. Like, Hoi has to, attack Karen into Sylvanas. Because if he loses Karen, then his N'Zoth gets extremely weak, and one Brawl can clean up almost anything. Not to mention that as long as he has Acolyte Brawl, he can, force his opponent to steal Acolyte, too, by throwing into N'Zoth. So this kind of puts Hoi in an awkward position where he's pretty much has to make sure Karen dies. So he does this, and then just kind of forced to play the removal game. And I guess Hoi doesn't really want to let terms be dictated by the Sylvanas, so at least he knows that Karen is dead, so N'Zoth can go in. That way he can get more damage to his opponent and shred the armor count. Now, what does this let Pavel do on the other side? That allows him to... Does he guarantee get a steal on a... Can he, guarantee clear the board and steal? It's a little bit tricky because the Sylvanas at one health, too.
Yeah, and he does draw into Bran, so...
Okay.
Do you want to get those rolling? I'm curious to see how many cards that Pavel has left in his deck to see if he puts the C'Thun's back, what's the likelihood that he starts drawing into them.
Right.
And if it's even worth it yet. Maybe he does want to try and guarantee a steal on something big. He could utilize the revenge here to... no, he can't utilize the revenge to steal. He can use Gore Howl to guarantee steal, sort of the Bane Bloodhoof or...
Yeah, I don't think I mind Gore Howl, because if you play Gore Howl, you kill off Elise Starseeker and you can guarantee the 4/5 steal. Your opponent plays Harrison Jones and you have Twin Emperor to make sure that the trades are awkward, plus you have the 4/5 for the easy trade there. So I actually think it's okay to sequence it for future turns this way. Because Twin Emperor Veklor is very logistically difficult. And if your opponent plays Harrison Jones on this and you play Twin Emperor Veklor, your opponent is actually kind of baited to Brawl to a certain degree, because Brawl doesn't really get much value again in this matchup. Oh, Harrison just comes in hand just on turn. But say he does play Harrison, his opponent plays Twin Emperor, Hoi might be really tempted to play Brawl, and then Pavel knows that he has free development turn on Brand Bronzebeard plus Doomcaller. And that's like a chain of turns that kind of puts Pavel in a snowballing momentum. He's the one taking initiative constantly. He's the one forcing Hoi into awkward positions. And he's the one who ultimately is going to be able to play the C'Thun's with less threats to worry about. Mm-hmm. And if Hoi is forced to brawl with Emperor and against the twin, with Harrison against the Emperor, he's also potentially losing his own Harrison.
That belongs in a museum. Still pretty far ahead in the fatigue race, even with Harrison being used. And you talked about it a little bit earlier on about how drawing that one card with Harrison is usually worth it in the case of Gore Howl because of how much value gets across the matchup.
Yeah.
You're getting one closer to fatigue, but you're also probably saving yourself from three or four resources at the very least.
Yep.
Being slain.
Okay. Brand Bronzebeard. I guess that Doomcaller comes out then.
Yeah, and if the Brand becomes a huge threat as well as the 7/8, and if Brand sticks, then you play Twin Emperor Veklor. It's sort of the second on the priority list with Brand Bronzebeard, but a lot of times the Brand will stick around on the board to make 3/4/6s as opposed to two going into the next turn. Shield Slam picked up, though. That's a nice piece of removal.
Yeah, that actually makes a lot more sense. I was thinking originally to play the Twin Emperor Challenge and pressure, force a Brawl, then play this. But this makes the upside of Brand. Like, if he does play Brawl and Brand survives, or the 7-9 survives, it's actually a pretty good outcome either way.
Yeah, you sort of want the you actually want the Brawls to be saved, because what you want to do is force out the hard removal before you force out the Brawls, because the hard removal has much less of a target.
Right.
So there's sort of a win-win, because if you get the hard removal out, that means your C'Thun's are going to be more likely to stick. If you get the Brawls out, that means your Twin Emperor is going to be more likely to stick. So it's not necessarily a win-win, but it's definitely like the correct way to sequence it in a way that allows you to get the most benefit out of your big minions that are on. And Hoi recognizes this, and I really like this. He recognizes that Brawl has less value as the game goes on.
But it's so awkward, because now you kind of want to Shield Slam this, but the upside of this play from Pavel is so high. Now Shield Slam was used on Brand. Now all of a sudden the Twin Emperors have a better chance, because Brawl has been used already.
Yeah.
And one of those C'Thun's came back too. That's also really threatening. So if the Veklor's or the Twin Emperors are able to get some damage in, you can shave off the remaining health and start pressuring your opponent. I really love the way Pavel's been able to control the pace of this game here, and Hoi's forced into awkward positions repeatedly.
It's the first Jessikar we've seen so far this game. That's kind of bizarre.
Yeah, Jessikar is something that you mulligan for pretty aggressively, usually in the slower warrior mirrors. So this is definitely an awkward situation for both. Hoi also seen that the two Twin Emperors are up, so potentially thinking about maybe N'Zoth, because if his opponent does Brawl, there's a chance that not only a good outcome where maybe his minions survive and Karen summons a minion, but he can also steal one of the 4/6s. So this is a tough spot for Hoi, because his hand's not exactly great. He's got 2 revenges, 2 executes, and while he could utilize them, he wouldn't be able to present threats, and he knows his opponent's getting thin on the deck count. So Pavel's eventually going to draw the C'Thun's.
Yes, he is. But the thing is will those C'Thun's be able to overcome N'Zoth, which is going to summon 2 Infested Taurens, a Sylvanas, and a Cairn. Which C'Thun actually doesn't do well against those, because you only get 1 attack, and the Battle Cry actually just shaves off some of the armor usually. So it's a really weird battle that takes place. Even if you get sort of the ideal use out of your cards, like in this situation where Pavel was able to kill off his own C'Thun, he was able to get Brand Doomcaller, he was able to get the threats in sort of a way that he wanted to, it still might not be enough because of the power of N'Zoth.
I think Pavel's really contemplating how he wants to play this turn. He technically can just pass. He can also play C'Thun to kind of threaten his opponent, but I think he's afraid of giving his opponent value in some of the other things, like execute, Tink Master. These are the kind of things that he's afraid of. So rather than just overextend onto the board, he knows he's at a pretty big initiative advantage, because he can keep his opponent's tank up in check by dealing 4 damage per 4 health gained, and force his opponent to be the one coming out with an answer. Because right now, Hoi, I mean, yeah, he has Golden Monkey map in his deck, and yes, he has N'Zoth in his hand, but he's got the perfect answer so far. So he's waiting for Hoi to do something, so that way Pavel can use his hand more efficiently.
Yeah, and at the moment, the fatigue battle isn't even... they're not that close. Hoi actually has 4 cards left in his deck now, and Pavel has 5 because of the extra cards he added from C'Thun.
Right. So that's also a huge thing too.
Pavel is actually sort of they're very even, but if you factor in like this turn he'll have 4, next turn they'll be even again. Mm-hmm. Pavel's actually ahead by a card in the fatigue battle, despite drawing early cards because of Hoi not being able to add extra cards to his deck with say Doomcaller and also drawing a card with Harrison Jones.
Yes, and there's also a problematic thing of if Hoi plays N'Zoth, Pavel will guarantee play Acolyte and Brawl to have him steal the Acolyte and then try to remove a lot. And that forces Hoi deeper into fatigue. The fact that Hoi doesn't have his Golden Monkey is very unsettling for him. And, again, Pavel's not forced to do anything. He just pass, keep his opponent's armor in check. He is ahead in the fatigue count. He's almost kind of got Hoi cornered into a checkmate position, because Hoi still doesn't have his map to the Golden Monkey. He doesn't have his threats. And without the real threats, how is he ever going to be able to push for a win in this game? Because Pavel can just play it safe. He's got his C'Thun's he can just use as removal, in fact.
Yeah, that's very true.
I mean, I feel like Koi might just play something here and execute. I think he's at 10 cards right now, so he can't just pass and let his opponent do something else and wait for a free turn development. So whether he chooses to play the Ravaging Ghoul and execute, or perhaps part ways with one of his revenges because it's a little bit clunkier to use. You know, and I don't think he can really play Nazoth here, given that he's known that Pavel's drawn 26 cards at his deck. It's really, really tough position for him, and I think he was really hoping for that map to the Golden Monkey.
Yeah. Dan, this sort of takes me back. I know you know this, but when I started playing Hearthstone, for my first, like, 3,000 ranked games, the only deck I played and constructed was Control Warrior.
Control Warrior. I remember. I remember that time fondly, TJ, like it was yesterday.
Yeah.
Because that's about the time you finished your 3,000th game.
And I know you remember also when I first started casting Hearthstone was around that time. And the only deck that I knew how to cast was Control Warrior as well.
You got pretty hyped over it, man.
Oh, yeah. I still get hyped over it. I know people always say, oh, man, super tank up.
You get hyped over this?
Oh, yeah.
The Golden Monkey. I think that's what Hoya was looking for. Now, if he hits that monkey on the next draw, I think there's only three cards remaining, then does he play it this turn? Because then he could execute 3-3 trade in the 6-3 and play the Golden Monkey, have a full turn of mana the next turn to be able to play whatever legendaries he gets. And some of the good ones are Anubarak, you know, the ones that summon other stuff too. Confessor Pagers ain't bad. Okay, Nazoth also forces his opponent to spend his entire turn brawling, which is also kind of scary given that you know your opponent can force you to take a Acolyte of Pain, but at least he's committed almost all of his mana to it.
Yeah. And with the, he's going to try to go with the reverse pressure line, which is sort of a necessity as you've been alluding to over the past couple turns. That map is ever so crucial in trying to get through this game because Hoi realizes that he's not going to really win the fatigue battle. If the players just sit here and do nothing, that Pavel's going to be the one that benefits the most from it.
Mm-hmm. So now Hoi knows that there's a lot of chance for his opponent to just clear a lot of these minions, play the brawl. So how does Pavel choose to go about sequencing? Just removing the first half of the torrents because the 2/2s are dead as well. Does he choose to just brawl straight up? Maybe he doesn't give the Acolyte, so that way he has more mana free to do other actions, like if he wants to execute a minion with the Ravaging Ghoul. That also gives him options as well.
Yeah, I mean, he has time.
Right.
Is the thing. So being able to have options is good. But I think since he realizes that Hoi is going for the plan of playing Nazoth this turn instead of waiting for C'Thun, means that he wants to start getting aggressive with it.
Oh, man. So stealing that Jeskar means Ravaging Ghoul execute is pretty strong. And then now he's able to get some board initiative. And he still has an Acolyte Brawl as well, in case his opponent was able to do anything with the Sylvanas on the following monkey plays. Bobbleson is still in a pretty good spot here. And Hoi is going to have to hope that his monkey is going to have a good outcome here.
Dan, if I was a superhero, my costume would have the tank up icon.
Yeah?
Right on the chest.
That's a pretty good one.
And my...
I'd probably have Life Tap, because I think that power is almost as good, but I think tank up's pretty good.
So your superpower would be to hurt yourself in order to gain more goods.
I mean, I cast Hearthstone. All right, so Golden Monkey, you play this, and you're able to get a bunch of legendaries from this position. Is there any 4-mana legendary that's like really good from the spot to play as well? Because he only has 4 mana remaining after this.
No. I mean, there's a few 4-mana legendaries, right? Gormok the Impaler.
Yep.
Ooh, what else? I mean,
nothing comes to mind, but I know
King Mukla would force your opponent to overdraw, so you could have him overdraw.
What if he discards one of his C'Thuns?
Well, he's got one of his C'Thuns in his hand, so there's one left in his deck, and I think he has 3 cards. So let's see. That's
all right.
That's a what we call in the industry a buttload of legendaries. Sir Finley is not necessarily that good, though.
No, and I think you want to keep your tank up. So he's going to just use his hero power here. Let's look at some of the minions that he's got. Ah. He's gotten a C'Thun. He's gotten a Bolf Ram Shield.
Double Baron Geddon, a Cho'Gall. Is that a Skeleton Knight tucked away in there?
Yeah, he doesn't have any removal, actually, for
Sky Captain Crack.
Because Sky Captain Crack, that card's kind of useless in this position.
Yeah, this game feels like it is...
Yeah, I mean, his C'Thun doesn't scale like his opponent. It's a 6-6 C'Thun. I think that's it. I think Hoi's going to evaluate his position, just think about his best options. But one of these is not like the other. And that's going to wrap up the game. Quite the marathon. As that was about over half an hour of gameplay. And Pavel does come out on top. And the score is 2-1.
Yeah, you can see that both players recognized how to play that matchup. Even from the get-go, you could tell the way that Pavel was planning. You could tell the way that Hoi was planning. Hoi realized maybe a little bit too late that he needed to go on a little bit more of an aggressive plan. I think that wasn't a fault of his own. That was just a fault of, you know, Lys being really deep in his deck and not having the resource available. So,
yep.
Fun match overall, though. And we're going to see what happens in game number 4 right after this. Welcome back, everybody. I'm TJ. That's Frodan. Felt like we needed to remind you guys, since we hadn't updated you on the current caster situation in about 40 minutes, because that's how long that last game was.
Yeah, it was pretty long, but I think that's what people want to see once in a while. They really want to get out of their system that some of these matches, which are slower, are very methodical, but they plan 6 to 10 turns ahead. I'm not exaggerating when I say that. A lot of times, these matchups, which require so much forethought into the end stages of the game, you're planning from turns 3 onwards, about turn 15 to 16 sometimes.
Sure, yeah.
And if you have a little bit of that sprinkled with a little bit of those cool tempo or aggro or combo decks too, I think it's a really well-diverse lineup. So I can definitely appreciate that gameplay from a Hearthstone fan's perspective.
Yeah, and now one of those control wards are out of the way, so now we got that sort of little refreshing look into what a control meta would look like. And
you say that as the Control Warrior player. You love Control Warrior. I don't know why you're more hyped over TJ.
I was hyped, but the thing is that Golden Monkey was very disappointing.
Okay.
He played Golden Monkey, and then he conceded.
Baron Geddens.
Yeah. Playing Golden Monkey, bad. Then playing a 6-6 C'Thun, and then conceding is not as hype as you might think it would be on the surface.
Now, what remains... 5 unique classes. I love this. I want to see more of this kind of stuff. Of course, we had Mage that was already stricken off the board, so 6 different classes in this series. Now, Rogue and Druid up against the Warlock, Warrior, and Shaman. I feel like Pavel's in a pretty prime position. And what a story it would be for Pavel to continue to go through the Europe Last Call as redemption. Remember, last year, Pavel ended his run unceremoniously, making one of the biggest mistakes I think we've ever seen in competitive Hearthstone to date, which is the Sylvanas Dr. Boom Molten Giant plays, and as a result lost to Life Coach, which could have been him going to BlizzCon. Can he do it this year by first taking out Hoi, who's also been on the come up for such a long time? Hoi, in my opinion, was 2015's Rookie of the Year performance. He did so well breaking out into tournaments like the Viagame House Cup and DreamHacks, where he was going undefeated in Swiss. He did such a good year in 2015 that his run was also a little bit unfortunate, running into his teammate twice to be eliminated.
Losing to the eventual world champion.
Yeah, losing to
twice.
The world champion twice. So both these guys have a lot on their plate to try to redeem themselves in 2016, but unfortunately one has to go here. Let's go into game number 4, Warrior versus Rogue. Now, Hoi had an opportunity to equip the Fire War Axe, chose not to. Is it that important to hero power, or is it important to conceal your information on the Fire War Axe? Why don't you break down this play, TJ?
Well, you know that your opponent is not going to play anything that's going to be killed by a Fire War Axe on turn 2, unless they coin out an SI agent, which... that really isn't going to be that big of a deal. So, you know, health, gaining the extra armor is a pretty big deal in this matchup because a lot of times it does come down to your armor count if you can manage to deal with the early threats.
Thank
but
you.
I do think that a lot of players think that this matchup is very close. I've always been under the impression that I feel like a Rogue, if piloted well, can do good things against most Control Warrior lists. So, especially ones that are relatively minion-heavy, because there's a lot of threats in Rogue that are must-kill, and even if you do kill them, you are still might be in a rough position because you have to use so many resources to do so. And cards like Tomb Pillager also just give them a coin.
Yeah, and that's not to be understated. The coin is extremely potent in a class like Rogue, which combos off of any card that's being played. Another possibility, too, don't forget about, by the way, X factors like Swashburglar, which always could end up deciding a lot of the tempo swings. You know, Bash doesn't look that impressive, but who knows if that ends up being a key that helps the Maligos deal 8 damage to face instead. But one thing to consider, too, is that Pavel's playing the Maligos Miracle version, which a lot of people have been starting to experiment with post-patch. However, Maligos Miracle Rogue has a limited amount of damage. Mm-hmm. And that is what's really scary, because Warrior is one of the classes that can out-heal effectively by having too much armor. You can't really bust through all of it with your Sinister Strikes that and Eviscerates that gain a lot of damage. Compared to the Questing Adventurer, which you can get multiple turns of hitting for, you know, 6 damage, then 12 damage, then maybe even more if you keep concealing.
Yeah, you still have repetitive damage from your powerful minions, but you have much less of a chance to sort of all-in your opponent early on and, so to speak, cheese early wins out of your opponent, which is a great, which can be a good way to deal with Control Warrior. But then again, if you can manage to draw through much of your deck relatively early on in the game, or force your opponent to take a lot of damage with weapons like Hoi has done, Maligos can even be better than its Questing Adventurer partner in crime.
Questing Adventures partner in crime. No, that'd be a great comedy series. Although, isn't the whole point of Questing Adventures like every one of us? We're all supposed to be the Questing Adventures in a way.
Yeah. I thought we were all supposed to be the Swashburglers.
I wish. I wish it was Pirate Day every day. The fact that he has Harrison Jones is also interesting. I always feel like timing this Harrison Jones is really important because you know that your opponent has a lot of, you know, threatening ways to build up their weapon, but not so in Maligos Rogue. Maligos Rogue actually doesn't have deadly poisons. So it's interesting that Pavel has chosen to replace the Swashbroker with those deadly poisons as one of those exchanges. And if so, when does Hoi even play Harrison Jones? Because it is a weapon class and it is a card draw, but he's not playing it. He's actually been holding on to it while playing Justicar to make sure you get that Tanka.
It's a very streamlined list from Pavel. There's very little one-ofs. You know, it runs like Double Shiv, Double Eviscerate, Double Swashburglar, Double Sinister Strike.
It's got the barn so that you can get that Maligos or Gadgetzan out, or the Tomb Pillager.
Yeah.
Of course, I'm always afraid getting barns on the Swashburglar. That's always one of the most awkward times.
Yeah, but there's very little misses, I feel like, in this deck. Especially since you do run Thor's Hand, you do run Maligos. There's, I feel like, a little bit less misses than if you run a version of, like, regular Miracle Rogue that also has Swashburglars, like any Swashburglar version. A lot of Rogue players actually are moving towards Swashburglar as being sort of a staple in their decks. Oof. So now that's a Baron Geddon.
Yep. Yeah, Baron Geddon forces Pavel to respond to it. It does a lot of damage. There is a world where the Control Warrior player threatens the Rogue player, but it's not really necessarily that common. Pavel's going to start off by drawing some coins with Gadgetzan. Saving coins also is valuable because of the way it interacts with Maligos spells. Maligos' damage can sometimes be best if used with Eviscerate and even preparations. Like, every coin you keep is just more damage for the late game.
You ever have that dream, Frodan?
I do tend to dream a lot, so hit me, TJ. What's with your dream?
Talk about the dream.
Oh, the dream. The one what is the dream in this matchup?
Where you're Baron Geddon and the world is 2 health minions.
Sounds like a great motivational poster.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The world is your 2 health minion.
Yeah.
And you are the Baron Geddon.
I wish, man.
Kill
I
it. Wish.
Unfortunately, I'm often the slime.
Oh, no.
And life is the Baron Geddon.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah. But not to depress people too much with my own woes, Van Cleef comes in here as a counter to that Baron Geddon. Oh, to that Grommash, excuse me. Baron Geddon, of course, not going to be that useful here. Hoi picks up ways that he can remove pretty efficiently. He has the Radical Execute. What's his follow-up if he chooses to do so? Not very strong. And I think one thing in the back of Hoi's mind, too, is that he also wants to start tanking up a lot. So if he wants to start tanking up, he's already working with only 7 mana this turn.
Also, if he uses Execute, what happens if Pavel just slams Maligos next turn? You know, does
very
he have a way
question
to deal with it? He hasn't been through that much of his deck. Pavel has already seen, you know, a little bit of removal. Would he feel confident in doing that?
Yeah.
I don't know if you really have a choice, and I don't know if he can even put Pavel on having the guts to slam a Malygos on a board like this. So he's going to go ahead and go for it.
Yeah. I mean, is it the first execute being used? If so, then you still have much to worry about because Hoi can execute the second one. All of a sudden, your win condition is gone. I expect Pavel to probably go for a second gadget stand here. Now he picked up preparation. He can draw a lot of cards and make sure he has enough so that way he can combo with his Malygos.
Prep Bash!
Prep Bash. Oh, yeah, oh, he's got backstab.
Yeah, you might
even better.
Maybe Prep Bash is going to be saved for the Malygos. Oh, there's sure. Sinister Strike. Now you got to think.
All he needs is just get the Emperor Thorsan, and he's going to have Bash, two Sinister Strikes for free with the Malygos. Oh, he's got the Emperor.
That is so much damage.
Does he want to save the Shiv? Because the Shiv also combos with Malygos as well, and you can use Bash a little bit more liberally.
Yeah. So if he reduces this, Malygos will be at 8. The Sinister Strikes will be free. He could fit in Bash more damage, so he could Malygos, double Sinister Strike, and Bash for 10 mana.
So that's 24 damage.
Yeah.
And if his opponent doesn't tank up, he puts him at 24 this turn.
Yeah, so he's going to go ahead and Blood Mage Shiv and
sure. The damage in.
Yeah, probably not attack just because if he's going... Oh, no, I think he's most likely going to dagger up next turn. So he's going to attack. Should attack.
Yes. I think next turn... Oh, man, Eviscerate. It's even more damage. It's 25 now. He's able to stretch it out. Not to mention that Gadget Stand might also damage, too. Say if his opponent attacks with the Fiery War Axe.
Yeah.
Tank up another removal piece, but Hoi is really starting now to count like what he can start doing here, especially by armor counts. If his opponent plays Malygos, can he respond to it? One of the things that's also inconvenient is that Pavel has used his dagger charge and now has not been able to play Harrison Jones for the value. He can play it for the tempo.
Yeah. Hoi's counting. He's like, oh, God.
Yeah. What's the amount of damage my opponent can do maximum to me?
It's like 100, 103. 106.
Carry
one. Start over.
I can't tell you how many times I've been in a position where I'm trying to count my opponent's damage and I just miscount halfway through and have to start over from the beginning. And the rope's burning.
you just forget it all.
Yeah. The microwave's dinging because my hot rolls are done. You know, my pizza rolls are done. You know, the cat's meowing. There's people knocking on my door for some reason. There's a lot of stress that comes in it, man.
The Mountain Dew delivery driver's there.
Yeah, there's a lot of things going on, but Hoi choosing to clear, use his own charge, and now with the Swashburglar potentially picking up more removal. Well, not really doing much there. Emperor Thorsan trying to discount as much as he can. Keep in mind that he doesn't have to use all of his burst and kill his opponent. He also can stretch it out by playing Azure Drake and preemptively loading the board, and then being able to also Malygos the following turn too. All he has to do is get his opponent down to that magical number, which is 25.
Mm. Yeah, he can use Azure Drake and then use some of the burn that he wouldn't be able to fit in with the Malygos. Mm-hmm. So that means he should be in a pretty good position. But that's a lot of armor gain.
Yeah, it's
for Hoi.
It's a lot to get through. Although it's not exactly the, things like Baron Geddon is removal. So if you bash Baron Geddon, but you also do 2 damage to yourself, so you're really gaining 1. And then you're at 28, if I count correctly.
What?
So 28. Can you die off of that? If your opponent has a preparation, you can die. Because
yes.
Your opponent discounted Malygos, discounted all those cheap spells, and the prep. Which, by the way, if Pavel has prep, then the magical number becomes 33. So... Hoi's in some tough spots, man. I don't envy his position because just the Malygos is so threatening, which is really cool. I love Malygos decks. And if Pavel draws the preparation, that is it. Right?
Is it?
I mean, he's got 24 from the 3 38 damage.
So 33
prep
total.
Eviscerate.
Yeah, he does.
So I think he has 33, and that should wrap it up.
That is a lot of damage, and Hoi can't really account for spells that are gained from Swashburglar. The only ones that would kill him would be
if he bashed,
Mortal Strike.
I think he would have survived if he bashed. which is crazy because he can't account for the Swashburglar.
He would have been one damage off lethal if he had bashed that turn instead of floating that three mana.
And he wouldn't have died to a pirate.
There are barely any spells in Warrior that actually deal damage. There's like Mortal Strike and Bash.
Oh, you can't play.
That's it.
How do you play around that? It's like, well.
And he even like sort of played
bash,
around.
Bash? Yeah, or you can have Blood Strike. Warriors.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't blame Hoy at all, given the context of that. But, you know, in hindsight, it is kind of funny they hit three mana remaining. He could have bashed. Could have been one damage over. And Malygos was almost out of cards, which meant he would have had nothing else to do at that point. And it's a very real thing where, like, because you're one damage off, you lose the game. Yeah. Because the Warrior just keeps tanking up, playing defensive. And you don't know what ends up happening from that position.
Yeah, well, Hoy is going to be contemplating his life, and I'll leave you to contemplate yours as well. We'll be back in a minute. Hello, guys. Welcome back. About to jump into game number five.
Yes, 3-1 to score. Pavel's in the lead. One game away from eliminating Hoy, and once again, ending his run early. Seems to be the theme for 2016 for Hoy. He does a great job getting to the process, right? Going through the process, excuse me. He gets to the championships. He gets to the prelims. He gets to the qualifier spot for the last call. Those are the past three big events he's been to.
But at the end of the day, he doesn't get the girl.
Oh, man. I think we can all identify as Hoy at one point of our lives. But at this point, Hoy's been eliminated early, very on, every time. Group stages, the very beginning of the prelims, and now potentially the big beginning of last call. But it's never over till it's over. There's one thing that I've learned in Hearthstone. You can't really predict what happens all the time. You can have expectations. You can be immensely favored. But I've seen people be up 3-0 and still lose four games in a row. So this is not over for Pavel. He has to start. He has to continue to be focused. And that's not a good start to his opening hand here. Malygos and Arcane Giant with no sign of ramp. Hoy, in the meantime, can just kind of bide his time. And the Control Warrior tends to be pretty good against the Malygos Druid because you can, once again, run the Malygos out of legitimate threats and then just win the game through tanking up.
Yeah. And like you talked about, you know, with Conquest, sweeps and comebacks are much more likely than other formats because you can isolate a deck. Conquest is a format where you can target one specific deck in your opponent's lineup. Maybe not so much in best of seven, but usually you can isolate that deck and either choose your best matchups against it or isolate that deck and that one being the one you're targeting specifically. And knowing that a lot of players are going to be Druid, maybe that's where strategy coming in. But Pavel's going to be very happy to pick up ramp or, you know, not ramp, something to play on this turn. He can roll into Emperor Thorstein if he so chooses.
Yes, and in fact, I feel like that is his only option here. Well, I guess he could also remove through Feral Rage, but Emperor Thorstein. Oh, actually, hold on. Okay, I'm trying to think about the innervate opportunities if he holds on for one more turn, but it just wouldn't do anything. Mm-hmm. So just you play Emperor Thorstein. Yeah, you don't discount the Moonfires or the innervates, but who knows? Maybe Malygos next turn when you innervate him can also be really strong if you pick up Living Roots. I mean, maybe it's one of those matchups where you just have to try and do something aggressive because it's kind of a bad matchup.
Yeah. He does get the reductions early on, mm-hmm. which means that'll open up a lot of opportunities for him later, but all this stuff that's in his hand is stuff that he's not going to be playing for a long time, unless he's taking a huge risk by playing Malygos onto the board early and potentially giving up his one of his only win conditions or, you know, his only win condition. He needs to draw into Nourishes, he needs to draw into more threats, and the deck is sort of lacking threats. But there's that one interesting little decision that Pavel decided to make with this Druid deck that not many other Druids decided to make.
Yeah, we saw in the opening mulligans, he has two Dark Arakoas, and he's not playing C'Thun Druid. Doesn't have C'Thun in his deck list. He just plays it because the 6 mana, 5-7 taunt body is still really beefy, and it's much faster than the Ancient of War because people feel like, yeah, it's only one mana difference. But don't forget, things like Mire Keeper and the way you kind of ramp off of Wildgrowth evenly makes it so that way if you hit into turn 6 and you have a taunt, it's much more common to see. By the way, we are seeing that Malygos double Moonfire Living Roots play that I suggested if he drew it. And that is 19 damage to the face. And he's just going all in, essentially, on
this. He's
going to
put him at 4.
5.
5. Sorry, I thought that was going to be 11.
He's going to put him at
close
5.
Close enough. Ran into the nearest 4.
He's going to put him less than 10.
Hoy is in an awkward position where he has to remove his Valley Ghost, but also fear for his life total. And if Pavel picks up any kind of damage source, like the swipe or, you know, perhaps another Feral Rage, he can end the game.
So Hoy's only way to survive here is to Ravaging Ghoul, execute Armor Up. He could Armor Up, Shield Slam, and execute, but then he doesn't really deal with the Arcane Giant that comes out next turn. Now, he can't know that, but he has to think, like, wow, if he went through all those spells to face, does he have the damage to back this up in his hand? There's a lot of spells that deal 4 damage plus 1 from the hero power that would kill him next turn if he didn't go above 5 this turn.
That was a turn 6, 19 damage combo. I don't even know how to respond. I definitely feel like executing would be appropriate, but then you can't develop a threat behind it.
Oh, no, he doesn't have to play the Ravage Ghoul. That's right, because he has a minion on the board. So
he's just going to pass. Pavel can draw a lot of cards here to kill his opponent, raging from the second Living Roots to another Feral Rage to swipe. Okay, so choosing to just play Feral Rage, get aggressive, because he knows he wants to use the end of the game anyways. I actually really like this play, too. A lot of people probably save the Feral Rage, but it makes sense, because you're not going to see a Feral Rage for defense. You're definitely going to try to be aggressive against your opponent.
Well, he doesn't... He has to Ravage a Ghoul, Coin Brawl?
Oh, man.
Is that his only way to survive?
I think that's his only way to survive.
Win a 50-50 and then still be at 3, even if he wins?
I think so, and if Hoy does not able to take out this giant with Brawl, that will be it. And Control Warrior excels at single target removal, but they need time. No armor to use Shield Slam. No shield block to help fish for stuff. No Big Game Hunter to be seen.
Oh, man.
That's pretty much it. No coin play into Grommash could save him. So let's see where this Brawl lands for the tournament life. What's going to happen, DJ?
Oh, geez. I'm stressed. Imagine Hoy's position right now. He's out of the... Oh, it is Ravaging Ghoul, but he's still 3 health.
But Nourish... Oh, man. Innervate doesn't really matter. He just needs to draw any of those cards.
Let's see.
Raven Idol gives him more outs. 2 outs.
Oh, my goodness.
10% chance to land on any spell he wants, but there's a lot of removal damage. You got to be trolling me.
Another Nourish. I mean, he's still second Raven Idol. That second Raven Idol could pick up Swipe, Living Roots.
Yeah. But let's wait for the second Raven Idol.
Okay.
Still looking for a spell. Can I get 3 damage, please, on the board?
There it is!
We have ourselves another semifinalist. Pavel's going to end Hoy's run here. And a job well done. The redemption story continues, TJ.
Yeah, but still a road ahead of Pavel. He'll go on to face... the winner of our next match in the semifinal. Keep in mind, last call invitational is winner take all. It's BlizzCon or nothing for these players effectively. So even though it's got to feel good to win that first match, still has 2 more that he has to get himself ready, prepare for, because he's got to play those today.
Yeah, fantastic. So a job well done here by Pavel. And I mean, his road isn't ending here. Remember, we're only taking one person from this 8-man invitational to just kind of go through to BlizzCon. It's going to be really tough because his opponent on the other side of the bracket are really tough already, but he has to worry about what's happening on the next series. But overall, I'm really happy with the way that series turned out, and a 4-1 victory is definitely a confidence booster against a player of Hoy's caliber.
Definitely, and a little disappointing for Hoy, but to give you guys... some deeper thoughts on that last match, as well as to hype you up for our final quarterfinal of the day. Let's send it over to the table with Fireband and Raven.
Thanks a lot, TJ. That was a kind of crazy series overall, but we can check out the bracket first just to remind everyone where we are up to, as the third series of the day has come to a close now. So we can see that, in fact, Pavel did beat Hoy, as we just saw. He's going to be the third semi-finalist, and he's going to be ended up facing up versus George C. or Nick Slay, whoever takes the next series. And that was a pretty crazy game overall. Although, by score, it looked very convincing for Pavel in terms of winning. It was 4-1. Mm-hmm. The matchups were very tense, very control-heavy in general. Sure. Do you think that was an easy one for Pavel? Because, you know, we look at what the score was. I think it was a bit closer than the score may have actually shown.
I think it was actually fairly easy for Pavel. If you just look at the lineups, Pavel's lineup is targeting Warrior. Hoi's lineup is also targeting Warrior. But then Pavel's Warrior is the greedy C'Thun Warrior, which just actually is greedier than the N'Zoth Warrior and is going to beat it in the mirror. So I think, you know, being able to secure up that matchup allows Pavel to very easily target out Hoi's Control Warrior, as we see him do in the series, and get some convincing wins. The Rogue was a little bit sketchy. You can see here relying on the card off of the Swashburglar to really close that one out, and Hoi, you know, not playing around the Swashburglar card as it is. It could have been anything,
didn't
literally.
Play around the Bash, that was a clear misplay.
Yeah, like, it's so hard to play around those kind of cards, so in the Rogue even being able to get a clutch win there. But yeah, I mean, lineup versus lineup, I think Pavel is supposed to win most of the time.
Yeah, and we even saw, like, again, just a lot of Pavel's decks being quite sort of late game orientated, even with the Rogue taking the Maligos variant as well. And he just managed to really piece everything together every single time and get the win. I think the Control Warrior mirror, even though it was, you know, slightly variant decks, of course, in forms of C'Thun versus N'Zoth.
Yeah, the C'Thun Warrior's win rate against the N'Zoth Warrior is just insane. Like, it crushes the N'Zoth Warrior just like almost every single time. So that decision to go with the triple C'Thun instead of going with the N'Zoth Warrior really paid off for Pavel, and I think it's the main reason why he was able to win this series.
Yeah, it was a strong performance over